today we're gonna be doing an overview of vital signs again. I'm gonna try to make this as painless as possible because I know you guys already went over all of this. So your vital signs, we have temperature, pulse, respiration, blood pressure, oxygenation, and some places consider pain as a vital sign. They'll get to that at some point, but pain can be considered a vital sign because it can alter the values of your other vital signs. Like, you know, pain can increase the blood pressure, it can increase the pulse, increase somebody's respirations. So we will start with a video, if I can see.
Five major types of vital signs, the normal ranges, and how to remember them. Don't miss the chart showing the normal values at the end. It's great for nursing and students. You can remember the main types of vital signs with the mnemonic BROD. The B stands for blood pressure. A normal blood pressure is less than 120 over 80. The R stands for respiratory rate, with the normal value of 12 to 20 breaths per minute. The O stands for oxygen saturation, with the normal range of 95 to 100%. Next is the T, which stands for temperature. A normal average body temperature is 98.6 Fahrenheit and can range from 97.8 to 99 Fahrenheit. Finally, the H stands for heart rate or pulse, with a normal range of 60 to 100 beats per minute. Here is a summary chart of the normal values. Pass your classes and exams using the study guides and PDF notes in the bio. Like and follow for more medicine made easy. What are the five major types of vital signs? The normal ranges, and how to remember them. Don't miss the chart showing the normal values at the end. It's great for nursing and students. You can remember the main types of vital signs with the mnemonic BROD.
Okay. So, again, just a super quick little overview. Something I thought you guys might like because it kind of looks like a TikTok. So we'll start with temperature. Temperature is the balance between the heat the body produces and what it loses. And then again, I put down there that term pyrexia, which also means febrile, so that's somebody with a high fever. Temperature is a neurologic and a workings between the neurologic and the cardiovascular system to regulate the temperature. So that's why sometimes people shiver when they have a fever. Temperature can also be altered by diseases of the spinal cord or the hypothalamus in the brain that can also alter temperature control, like if there's a disease process there, like a tumor or something. And then some considerations would include age, hormonal changes, exercise, hydration status, illness, recent intake of food or liquid, stress, the person's environment, and their circadian rhythm. All those things can alter a person's temperature at any time. So some nursing interventions for temperature. I did this as like how you would take a temperature. So you would need an electronic or disposable thermometer, the probe covers. You would do your hand hygiene, provide privacy for the patient, and put gloves on if it's applicable. And then you would gently place the probe of the thermometer under the tongue in the posterior sublingual pocket, the lateral center of the lower jaw. So basically, like when somebody opens their mouth, you can look under their tongue, and they pull their tongue up, you'll see the little connecting ligament, and then right in the back, in between the back of the jawbone where the teeth are, and the that piece of tissue that connects the tongue to the bottom of the mouth. And you don't want to take an oral temp on patients who have facial trauma, breathe through their mouth, and you want to wait 15 to 30 minutes after eating, drinking, or smoking to take an oral temperature, because all those things can alter the temperature, which could alter any intervention that you might have to do. And you would document it as Celsius or Fahrenheit, based on the facility preference that you work at, and any associated symptoms such as clammy, cold, warm, diaphoretic, and then your expected temp in Celsius is 36 to 38 degrees Celsius, which is 96.8 to 104 degrees Fahrenheit. That's at the bottom. So that picture there is example of where you put the probe, and then a chart with different temperatures. It starts with an oral temp and the forehead for normal to fever temperatures, then under the arm, which they sometimes do, and rectal and ear temperatures. Some fever interventions, remove any blankets, you can increase their fluids, ice packs and cooling blankets. For ice packs, you would put them under their arms, in the groin, on behind their neck, on top of their head. Antipyretics, which are things like Tylenol or ibuprofen. And then you might want to do some lab work or blood cultures if their fever is pretty high. So pulse is a measurement of the heart rate and rhythm. It's equal to the ventricular contraction. You guys know what the ventricles of the heart are, right? And it corresponds to the bounding of blood flowing through various points in the circulatory system. It provides information about circulatory status. So your pulse can help you decide if somebody has a vascular issue. Like we talked about on Monday, say you can't get a pulse in somebody's groin, you have a hard time behind the knee, but they have a great pulse in their foot, you know that their vascular status in their leg is probably pretty good. But say maybe you can get a pulse in the femoral pulse, maybe you can get a pulse in behind the knee, but you can't get anything in the foot. Maybe that, you know, denotes that they have a clot in their leg, or they have maybe some kind of other vascular disease. And in that case, you would use a Doppler. Some considerations for pulse. We talked about the dysrhythmias. There's a pulse deficit. You know, if there's a difference between the apical pulse and the pulse you feel in somebody's wrist or in another place, sometimes there's a slight difference in the number of beats. Age can be a consideration for pulse. Somebody's disease state, if they're in pain, if they're having anxiety. And some good, easy ways to remember considerations for pulse are stress, positioning, pathology. So stress obviously is going to change somebody's pulse rate. Their positioning can change their pulse rate. If they're laying down, resting, it might be a low pulse. If they're standing, it might be a little higher. And pathology is their disease state changing their heart rate. So the nursing interventions, you need either a clock or a watch with the second hand for counting the pulse, and then a stethoscope for the apical pulse. So again, hand hygiene, provide privacy for your patient, put gloves on. You locate the radial pulse, which is always on the thumb side of the forearm at the wrist. Everybody has little wrinkles on their wrist, so you can kind of use that as a landmark. And it's okay to ask people to move their wrist around so you can feel the pulse. Sometimes you don't feel it right away. Sometimes you gotta move around a little bit to see, okay, yeah, I can feel it more there. Like we talked about before, you don't use your thumb, you're gonna feel your own pulse with your thumb. Some people find it easier to use three fingers to find a pulse. Some people find it easier to use two fingers to find a pulse. Just depends on how big your own fingers are. You'll feel under your fingers the tendons in your wrist. That's too far towards the middle. You're not going to feel a pulse there, but right here, you're not going to feel a pulse there because that's going to be your tendons if you move over on the side. So then you'll assess a pulse for 30 seconds, looking for rate, rhythm, amplitude, and quality. You'll multiply the number of pulses by 2, and this is the rate per minute. If it seems irregular, you would compare with the apical pulse. So assessing and describing pulse. Our normal number of beats per minute is 60 to 100. That would be the rate that you describe it as. The rhythm is the regularity of the impulses. Is it premature, late? Is there a missed pulsation? All these can indicate an arrhythmia, which is an abnormality of the electrical conductivity of the heart. And then you would document the strength. So it reflects the volume of blood ejected against the arterial walls within each heart contraction and the condition of the arterial vasculature, so just the vascular system. And it should be same beat to beat, and it's graded on a scale of 0 to 4. So if you don't feel a pulse, you're gonna grade it as absent, 0. If you feel it, it's diminished. describe it as 2+. If it feels really like it's increased, it's full volume, you can really, like, you're just, you know, barely touching, putting a little bit of pressure on, you can really feel it. That's a 3+, and a 4+ is full volume, strong. You just basically place your finger on them and you can feel it, no pressure. And then the equality, pulses should be equal and symmetrical on both sides of the body. If they aren't, again, that can indicate a disease state, a thrombus, aortic dissection, some kind of trauma. One thing I always like to talk about with students is when you're documenting, make sure you can see your pulses because, make sure you can see all of their limbs, because sometimes you'll find in people's documentation, somebody's got an amputation and they document bilateral pulses in their feet. So obviously that's wrong. So make sure you look for all your limbs before you document any pulses, definitely. So just quickly on the apical pulse, the apical pulse is the point of maximum intensity in the heart. It's taken for 1 full minute, and it's the anatomical position in the body is just under the 5th rib in the 5th intercostal space, on the left side of the chest at the midclavicular line. Sometimes with females, depending on like chest and breast anatomy, you might have to lift up a breast. Obviously, you know, they're gonna say, do you mind if I, you know, move things around and place my stethoscope? It could be uncomfortable for a minute, but we're just gonna do it for 1 minute. And it's always taken in cardiac patients, especially patients with an arrhythmia. Pulse site, so there is, right here, is the apical area. Oops, I forgot this is a touch screen. So that's like the left ventricle. And then your pulse sites on the body, your carotid, brachial, radial, ulnar, femoral, popliteal, posterior tibial, and dorsalis pedis, which is the on top of the foot. Just a little chart for you guys to see. And then, like we talked about again, the Doppler can be used to find difficult pulse sites before alerting a provider that you can't find a pulse. And again, always check your distal pulse sites. And then here's the radial pulse, just some pictures of where to find it, different ways you can take it. Sometimes you might be coming at somebody from this way, sometimes you might be coming from somebody this way. Either way, it's still going to be in the same position. Your position could be different. And your apical pulse and your radial pulse should be the same. Pulse deficit, which we talked about a little bit, the difference between the apical and the radial pulse due to vascular abnormalities or disease, trauma, or thrombus. Respirations. This is a big little paragraph here. So chemoreceptors in the carotid arteries in the aorta monitor the CO2 levels in the blood, causing an increase or decrease in the respirations to expel excess CO2 or intake increase the intake of O2. Rising CO2 levels in the blood will trigger the respiratory center in the brain and increase or decrease the respiratory rate. Respiration, you have three different parts of it. It's ventilation, diffusion, and perfusion are all to do with respirations. And your considerations for your respiratory rate would be age, sex, are they in pain, are they anxious, their positioning, any kind of medication. Some medications can be respiratory depressive. Do they have neurological injury, their disease state? Do they have an impaired oxygen carrying capacity of the blood? Sickle cell disease, how's their hemoglobin? Is it low, same with hematocrit? Do they have an anemia? So your nursing interventions for respirations, again, hand hygiene, privacy, you'll have on gloves if it's applicable. Watch the clock or your watch with the seconds hand. Again, you're always gonna want something with the seconds hand. I know some of you have the setting on your Apple Watches. Is it a specific setting you have to set it to? You have to like go in and change it? Okay. So your patient can be in semi-Fowler's position, and you want to make sure the chest is visible, nothing on top of the chest. They can obviously have clothes on, but no pillows or blankets. You want to make sure you can see at least their clothing and their chest for the rise and the fall. You can have a patient put their arm on their chest, so you can see it better move up and down a little bit. Because sometimes it is difficult to see, especially if the room is dark. But if you see, you know, somebody's skin is light and they're on like a dark shirt or something, you might be able to see it a little bit better. You want to observe one full respiratory cycle before you start counting. So an in and an out. And then you begin counting for 30 seconds, multiplied by two to get the rate for 1 full minute. And you want to note depth and rhythm. And a little nurse trick we talked about on Monday, after assessing and calculating your pulse, keep your hand on their wrist or your stethoscope at their apical site and watch the respiratory cycle for the next 30 seconds. They're going to think that you're still taking the pulse. So they're probably not going to talk. The respiratory rate isn't going to change because they're not going to be thinking you're looking at them breathing. Describing and assessing respirations. So your rate, the depth and the rhythm. The rate is the number of full respirations, full inspirations and expirations in 1 minute. Observe the number of times the chest rises and falls. The expected respiratory rate for adults is 12 to 20 a minute. That's an important one. Depth, the amount of chest wall expansion that occurs with each breath. Is it deep or shallow? And the rhythm, observation of breathing intervals. An expected finding for an adult is regular rhythm with an occasional sigh, that's apnea, and pauses in rate and rhythm of respirations is apnea. So those are all your different breathing patterns that you could potentially document. You don't need to know all of these at this moment. That's later on, but I wanted you guys to be able to at least have a reference for them. And then we'll move on to blood pressure. Blood pressure can get a little bit complicated because it looks like there's some mass in there, but really there isn't. So physical determinants of blood pressure are the cardiac output and the systemic, which is the peripheral vascular resistance. So blood pressure is equal to cardiac output and systemic vascular resistance. Cardiac output is determined by heart rate, contractility ability of the heart, blood volume, the venous return. An increase in any of these will increase your cardiac output and your blood pressure, and a decrease in any of these will decrease your cardiac output and the blood pressure. And then the systemic vascular resistance reflects the amount of constriction and dilation of the arteries and the diameter of the blood vessels. Are they wide? Are they small? An increase in systemic vascular resistance will increase the blood pressure, and a decrease in it will decrease the blood pressure. And it's documented as milliliters of mercury. So you have your systolic blood pressure, which is the top number. It indicates how much pressure your blood is exerting against the artery walls in each beat. And then the diastolic blood pressure is the second bottom number, indicates how much pressure your blood is exerting against your artery walls while the heart is resting in between beats. So systole, diastole. Some considerations for blood pressure. Age is always a consideration for all of these. Somebody's circadian rhythm, stress, their ethnicity, sex, some medications, do they exercise, obesity, family history, are they a smoker, and obstructive sleep apnea. So this is straight from the American Heart Association. This is a chart that describes blood pressure category, gives you the systolic and the diastolic numbers. So the top is normal, which we're going to see is great. Less than 120 and less than 80. And then again, you can look at it. It goes down, elevated, gives you, is it stage one, stage two? Is it a hypertensive crisis? Again, higher than 180 and or 120. Just a little quick slide on talked about on Monday, that hypertension is a silent killer. Some people don't know that they have high blood pressure until, you know, they go to the doctor for the first time in 3 years and it's really high, and, you know, then their whole life changes. But you need 3 documented elevated blood pressure readings to consider hypertension as a diagnosis and begin treatment. Primary hypertension comes from sodium retention, insulin resistance, or genetics. Secondary hypertension, like we talked about the other day, is a renal cardiac issue. So if you have kidney problems, sometimes it can cause issues with your blood pressure. Peripheral vascular resistance can increase diastolic pressure, which I thought was interesting. And then hypotension is low blood pressure, maybe described as soft, so really anything under 100 over 60. And some things that can cause hypotension: dehydration, sepsis, and then you can have patients that have orthostatic hypotension, which is a drop in blood pressure with positional changes. So your nursing interventions, the same things. We'll start with hand hygiene, privacy, put your gloves on. If somebody smoked or had any caffeine 30 minutes before, you want to wait until you're past that 30 minutes, because it can affect their blood pressure. And then you want to let somebody rest 5 minutes before a measurement and have an empty bladder. A full and distended bladder can increase your blood pressure. Your patient should be in like an office setting, or then, you know, a normal setting where you're just meeting somebody, taking their blood pressure. They should be sitting up in a chair with their back supported, feet flat on the floor, not dangling if you can avoid it, and not having their legs crossed. They don't want their ankles crossed either. Back and arm supported, and your arm at the level of their heart, their arm at the level of their heart, even if that means you're supporting it. You don't want them to be talking, leg bouncing, hand tapping. And you should measure in an arm free of injury, an IV placement. You don't want to take a blood pressure on somebody that has a mastectomy on one side, or a dialysis fistula. I don't know if any of you guys have seen those, but you don't want to take a blood pressure on the side that has a fistula. So you have your auscultatory method. You average 2 more readings taken at least 2 minutes apart if you're unsure about them. And then you would document the blood pressure, the side you took it on, and the position they're sitting in, and some lifestyle modifications, the DASH diet, which we talked about on Monday, frequent and continued monitoring, and education on home monitoring. That one was really important, the caffeine or nicotine, for 30 minutes before you want to wait. Same thing, you want them to be supported in their position. So just some pictures of manual blood pressure cuff, the different parts, what they're called, and then the stethoscope. We talked about this a little bit this morning, the bell and the diaphragm. The bell is the small squat top at the bottom, the little small circle, and then the diaphragm is the bigger one. And again, you can turn those, you use them for different things, but you guys will focus on using the diaphragm.
RN.com, and today I'm going to demonstrate how to check a blood pressure manually. First, you'll need to perform hand hygiene and gather your supplies. You'll need a stethoscope and a manual blood pressure cuff. So let's measure a blood pressure manually. To do that, we want to make sure our patient is sitting down with their arm at heart level and their legs are uncrossed. Now they're lying in bed, you want to make sure that this arm is at heart level. Then what we're going to do is we are going to get our stethoscope and our blood pressure cuff. And you want to make sure you get the right size cuff for your patient's arm, because if you use too big of a cuff or too small of a cuff, it can throw off the reading. And what we're going to do is we're going to palpate the brachial artery, because this is the artery we're going to be listening to get our blood pressure, because we're going to be getting our systolic number, which is that top number, and this is the first sound we hear. And then our diastolic. hear the sound. So whenever we're looking at the gauge of our blood pressure cuff, we want to make sure we're really noting those points, because it's going to tell us our systolic and diastolic number. So what we're going to do is we're going to put our cuff on our patient, and we want to make sure we find the brachial artery. This is the artery we palpate that we'll be using to determine our blood pressure. It's found in the bend of the arm. So we're going to find it, and it is located here. And we're going to look on our cuff, and our cuff has these arrows. And because this is the left arm, we're going to make sure that this arrow is pointing in that direction of where that artery is. So you're going to put the cuff up about 2 inches above the bend of the arm. First, what we want to do is we want to estimate the systolic pressure. So we want to find that number. To do that, we're going to palpate the brachial artery, and we're going to inflate the cuff until I no longer feel the brachial artery. And at that point, when I no longer feel it, I need to make sure I'm looking at this gauge to know that number, because that number is our estimated systolic pressure number. Then when I go to take the blood pressure, I'm going to inflate the cuff 30 millimeters of mercury more than that estimated number. Now the whole reason for doing that is because we want to avoid missing the oscillatory gap that can occur in some patients. Not all patients have it, but some. It's usually patients with hypertension. Because the oscillatory gap is like this abnormal silence that can occur, and it will throw off whenever you actually hear that first sound, which is your systolic number. So I'm inflating the cuff by filling on the artery, and I'm going to note the point where I no longer feel the artery, which is about at the 100. Then I'm going to deflate it completely and wait about 30 to 60 seconds, and then we'll take the blood pressure. So our estimated systolic number is 100. Now I'm going to inflate the cuff to 130, and that will avoid missing the oscillatory gap if one was present. So I'm going to take my stethoscope, put it in my ears. You can use the bell or the diaphragm of your stethoscope. I like to use the bell because it's best at picking up low pitch noises. So we're going to place that over the brachial artery, do it lightly. Don't fully compress it because you can occlude the artery. Then we're going to inflate our cuff to 130 millimeters of mercury. And we're going to let it fall about 2 millimeters of mercury per second. And we're listening for that first sound, which is our systolic number. Okay, it's 104. And we're listening for that last sound. 78. So the blood pressure is 104 over 78. Then once you have your reading, make sure you fully deflate the cuff full of air, and you're going to take the cuff off of your patient, of course, and clean it if it's not disposable, and you will document the blood pressure and what arm you took it in. Now, what are normal blood pressure readings? According to the American College of Cardiology 2017 updated guidelines, a normal blood pressure is a systolic less than 120 and a diastolic less than 80. Elevated blood pressure would be considered a systolic of 120 to 129 and a diastolic less than 80. Hypertension stage 1 would be a systolic of 130 to 139 or a diastolic 80 to 89. And hypertension stage 2 would be a systolic greater than 140 and a diastolic greater than 90. Okay, so that is how to check a blood pressure manually. Thank you so much for watching, and don't forget.
Okay. Oops. Anyway, she's great. Her videos are great. If you guys like to watch YouTube videos, she explains it. The one thing she did say that I don't like on there is she uses her bell for blood pressures. You guys, like we talked about, you'll use your diaphragm. Some people like to do it that way, but I prefer diaphragm, which is what I would assume you guys do.
Right, the diaphragm.
Oh, no, sorry. Alright, so pulse oximetry. So it's a non-invasive indirect measurement of the oxygen saturation of the blood.
So are you locked up?
No.
No.
The percent of hemoglobin that is bound with oxygen in the arteries is the percent saturation of hemoglobin. That's your percentage for your oxygen. So normal oxygen in adults is 95 to 100. That's what's expected. Some disease states can allow for a saturation as low as 85 for people that have COPD. Their oxygen that they live at all the time is going to be lower, and that's how they function. So, you know, somebody has a diagnosis of COPD, and you take their oxygen, and maybe they don't have oxygen on, and it's 87, 88. We're not going to go running and calling the provider unless they're struggling. And then it's the same considerations as respiratory rate, so age, sex, anxiety, pain, all that. Nursing interventions, hand hygiene, privacy for the patient, put your gloves on. You'll find your pulse oximeter, so it's either will be a digital probe or an earlobe probe or a disposable sensor. You'll choose an intact and non-edematous area, so an area that doesn't have any edema, swelling, no injuries, no open skin. You place the probe on a finger, a toe, on the bridge of somebody's nose or an earlobe for those who have advanced peripheral vascular disease. And when the readout stabilizes, you'll document it as a percentage. You don't want to take the first number that pops up. Let it go, it's going to go back and forth for a few seconds, let it just kind of stabilize. And you want to make sure on the pulse ox, especially the little ones, that you see the pulse rate on there, because that's when you know when pulse rate is stable, that's when your oxygen is a stable number that it's. And then just some examples, again, the little one up in the top left, the top number, the 99 is the percentage of oxygen, and then the heart rate. And then this other one at the bottom is the same as, I think, the ones over there on that machine, the Dynamaps. It clamps on the finger, and then it reads out on the screen. I took all this stuff, most of it, from your ATI Fundamentals textbook. And on page 143 has application questions. They're really good questions. I suggest you look at them. And the answers are, and with rationales, are on the following page. And you never know, they could be on your test. We're not going to watch this video just because of time, but it's like 6 or 8 minutes. It just goes through somebody taking a full set of vital signs. It's pretty good. You can watch it on your own time, but we're going to be doing all that anyway. And then there's your references. So again, it was just your ATI textbook and the American Heart Association website.